Hallelujah. Welcome to worship here at Ingle Farm Salvation Army this morning. It's a lovely day. Not too hot, not too cold, just delightful. And I feel that we are blessed. We are blessed to live in this country. We are blessed to have such special environment, an environment of safety, of peace and tranquility. And we acknowledge our Father God who has given us this space, who has made all things come together for us. We acknowledge him, and we also acknowledge the traditional custodians of this beautiful land on which we gather, particularly this plot of earth, the traditional owners of the Kaurna people, and we pay respects to their elders, past, present and emerging, and remind ourselves that the Salvation Army and we as members and friends of the Salvation Army are committed to reconciliation at every possible opportunity. Lord, give us the grace to be gracious in this. I want to share with you some challenging verses from Psalm 15. They say, Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? Who may live on your holy mountain? The one whose way of life is blameless, who does what is righteous, who speaks truth from their heart, whose tongue utters no slander, who does no wrong to a neighbour, and casts no slur on others, who despises a vile person but honours those who fear the Lord, who keeps an oath even when it hurts and does not change their mind, who lends money to the poor without interest, who does not accept a bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things will never be shaken. Amen. Amen. May that example be something that we can strive for. Some of those words in there are challenging, especially when people get in our way or annoy us somewhat. We pray that God will give us the grace to treat those in the way that we would like to be treated as well. The band has introduced to us the tune of the first song for this morning. And it says, to God be the glory. Great things he has done. You know what? Even if he hadn't done any great things, we still should be giving God the glory, yes? Yes. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life, an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. That was Jesus' work on the cross for us. Today, our theme is about being Jesus-centered, having him as the center of all we think, say, and do. So I'm going to invite you to stand, and we will sing the first two verses with the chorus. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there someone who'd like to read out the words of the third verse before we sing them today? Now, I always thought that this song was about praising God the Father, but I realised that the praise is through Jesus and his action that it's always referring to. And so that's been a really interesting lesson for me to learn this week. We're going to lift up, you're singing well, we're going to lift up the third verse and chorus. Thank you. Amen. Amen. Please be seated, and I invite you to give your attention to Greg as he comes and shares some good news.
Good morning, your farm. Hey, top of the day to you. Top of the day. Love to see you all today on this beautiful day in South Australia. Well, we've all enjoyed watching the self-denial pool videos on the screen there. Envelopes will be available next Sunday if you're willing to give. So next Sunday, there'll be envelopes here waiting to pick up and fill them full of money. Okay. Okay, just letting you know, people do food preparation in our main kitchen, the kitchen to my left, our main kitchen. The knives have been beautifully sharpened by our good friend Mark. So when you go to the kitchen next and doing food prep, the knives will be sharp. Praise the Lord. This afternoon, people, 4 p.m. is Messy Church. Learning all about my good friend Jesus. On the screen, no. Having a community this month is pasta sauce and chicken tonight. We want chicken tonight. Everybody knows the ad. So quite easy, pasta sauce or chicken tonight for loving our community. Zoom meetings, we're all tech savvy here still, aren't we? So if you're bored on a Sunday afternoon, Sunday evening, the Zoom meeting is still there till the last weekend of April with the lovely Paul and Wendy Hatley from 6:30 to 7:30. Details of that in the newsletter. Okay, people, enjoy your day. Don't forget further information, grab a newsletter. Enjoy the meeting.
Good morning, everybody. Off to the prayer table, of course. So last week was all about praising God and what we could praise him for. This week we're turning to thanks. So the verse, I didn't bring it with me, can't see unless I put my glasses on, but it's about thanking God in prayer. So again, I've got the alphabet. And you can write on the list anything you'd like to thank God for. So it could be the fact that he loves you and he saved you, but it could be that you like trees, that you like the sunset, that you thank him for your family. So anything that you want to thank God for, please come, write it on the list so that we get a big list of things that we can thank God for. I've also left the praise things up, so if you just want to come and praise him, you can do that too. So please come, use the prayer table so that we can encourage other people. During the week, it's out in the foyer and many people come and have a look. So write what you're thanking God for, spend time thanking him, and we can encourage our community to know our God as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. It's the first Sunday of the month, and so here at Ingle Farm that means it's the day that we come and select a name of either an individual or a family that we're going to be praying for the rest of the month. And so we come forward to select them, we're going to listen to a beautiful song called Somebody Prayed for Me. Because even if not all of our pieces of paper get collected, we still allocate those names for people to be prayed for, so that everyone who is a regular attender at our worship service here on at Ingle Farm gets prayed for. So everyone is welcome to come and take a name. Even if you're not a regular visitor here, you're still welcome to come, because prayer is prayer wherever it's from. Is that right? Amen. And if you have no clue about who the person is on your sheet of paper, come and see me after church and I'll point them out to you or explain who they are, okay? So when you get your name, go back to your seat and start praying for them then. Don't catch up with your neighbour about what you're going to have for breakfast tomorrow or whatever else. Spend this time in prayer, okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
God, we thank you for the privilege it is to pray for one another. May we be diligent in offering those prayers. May they be the prayers of what you want for them, not what we want for them. And we thank you, Lord, for each and every name listed on the pieces of paper that we have before us. And we just ask that you would allow us to be more and more like you each and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We are up to week 4, I think, of our self-denial videos. Might be, yeah. Whatever week we're up to, we're hearing about Tonga today. So that'll be cool. So sit back and enjoy the evidence of where some of our money has gone to help projects in Tonga in the past. And that gives you a glimpse of what it might be that our money for this year's appeal can go and help communities similar to this. Thank you.
Jesus, let your love shine through us. Oh, let it lead to action.
As a child in Tonga, I grew up in one of the islands of the Hapai group. I never heard of preschool. When I grew up in the island, we usually play with the sand or sticks, and we never had toys and dolls and all that. But when I moved to Tongatapu, I just go straight to primary school, and then from there to secondary school, and then get a job so I could help my parents and my siblings. I never planned to become a teacher. I first met the Salvation Army in 2008. That's when I took my first course training at the ECE. The Salvation Army helped me in many, many things. They gave me an opportunity to do my training so I can take my course in the foundation and even let one of my children be one of the scholarship, providing for her school materials and her school fees. My name is Meleafu, and I'm the head teacher of the Salvation Army Kindergarten at Kolobai. I help the children in the kindergarten to develop holistically, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. We set up everything to help the child to develop in their playing and the activities that we are providing. I'm pretty excited how the kindergarten here is helping with the community. Most of the parents don't have any income. Usually they can't afford the school fees. So the Salvation Army helped them by giving them a scholarship so the child can start coming to school. When I work with the children, I see God in them. Whenever I see those smile and those little innocent faces, I feel like God is watching me and I'm doing this for Him. Salvation Army is like a helping hand, not only a church here in Tonga, but they help a lot with the community. God has a plan, and I know this is my call from God to become a teacher. I never think that one day I'll be a head teacher. He got his own time for me to do things that I never think I can be able to do. I would like to say thank you for all the help from the Salvation Army and all we received to provide for our school and our kindergarten here in Tonga.
The Salvation Army in Tonga has been at the forefront of preschool education for nearly 3 decades. Our kindergartens have made a significant impact on the lives of children. And we've done this by sharing God's love and providing holistic education. In this way, hundreds of children have been impacted throughout the years. Programs like this are possible through your giving in the past self-denial appeals. And I encourage you to show love and action by giving generously to help those in need around the world. Thank you, and God bless you. Tapuaki moe malo. Ofalahi atu.
Good morning. Our Bible reading this morning comes from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23, and I'm reading from the New International Version. And the subject is the supremacy of the Son of God. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. God have understanding to his word today.
Thanks, Heather. Well, we're going to take the opportunity to sing together again, and this song talks about the action, the life of Jesus. And it says, above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms and thrones and wonders the world has ever known, or wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. And the chorus says, crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Such beautiful words, such truth, such theology, and we're going to share it in song, being led by the band. Thank you.
Nature and all creation.
So we're going to continue in our worship as we give of our tithes and offerings just now, and we know that we'll be blessed as that occurs. It's an act of worship, so enter into it as such. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard. Let us pray. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, Father God, we come to you this morning because we want to worship you and adore you. We are so privileged to come into this place and draw aside just to be able to listen to your word, to hear what it is you have to say to us. And because of that, we want to give back. We want to give back because you give so much. And Lord, we thank you that we have this opportunity to give of our tithes and offerings. And Lord, as they are used in this community, we pray that they will be used wisely, that they will be multiplied. And as we meet people in their deepest need, we pray that we can help them in a practical way, but also bring the good news of your son Jesus to them at the same time. We pray that we might have that opportunity every day, that your kingdom will grow here in this community and surrounding area. And Father God, we give you the thanks that we can do that, that we can be your messengers here. Father, we thank you for your many blessings, that we might be a blessing to others. And we ask, Lord, that we might hear you, have what your word is for us today. Open our hearts, our minds, to what it is you want us to know this morning. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello. Oh, there we go. Can I please have all the kids up here with me? So, have any of you guys played the game Follow the Leader? All right. So, Today we're going to play Follow the Leader first. All right, so everyone stand up. We know the basic rules of Follow the Leader, right? Do this. Is anyone else that want to have a turn? And being the leader? Come on. Someone's got to give it a shot. Come on. Anyway. All right. All right, so now we're going to add a little bit of a challenge with this. All right, we're going to put on blindfolds. How many fingers am I holding up? All right, follow what I do. Does anyone else ever want to have a turn to be the leader? All right, Chloe, come on. Give it a shot. You're not really doing that, are you? All right, everyone take their blindfolds off. All right. We can all sit down now. No more. So, was it a bit hard to follow what I was doing when you had the blindfolds on? Because you couldn't see what I was doing. So, has there ever been a time in your life where someone's told you to do something, but instead you've tried to do something else? Does anyone want to say one of those times?
What? Becky told me to not jump on her back because it would mess it up, but I did it anyway.
Anyone else? All right, so there's been a couple of times in my life where I've done that. So there was this one time when I was 8 and I was given the very cool job of being the ring bearer. And I was very proud and I was very excited. And I got this cool little pillow with a knot on it. And I was told not to play with this fancy knot because it had the rings attached to it. So we're at the wedding and guess what I did? I played with the knot and guess what happened? The rings fell on the ground and it was outdoors as well. So it was in the grass. So while Mum and Dad are officiating my auntie's wedding, I had all the groomsmen trying to find these two rings. There was also another time where we were playing a game of basketball for my team, and I wasn't having a really good game. And my coach had told us not to take some silly shots that I was taking, and I probably should have taken some more smart shots. So I got out of the huddle, got the ball back, was dribbling up the court, and one guy yelled out, oh, he probably won't shoot it. And I was like, well, I am. And then I very badly missed it and then got subbed out for good reason as well. So the way this relates to the story is that the story today is that Jesus is the person we should always listen to and follow. And when I was talking about a prompt with Mum to figure out what I was going to do for kids' time, she said, it's like if you didn't have a head. Now, that might sound very silly, but it actually makes really good sense because Jesus should be the way we listen, we hear, and we see everything because we can always trust that he will make the better judgment for us. And if you're feeling lost and you're feeling like you don't know what the right decision is, there's one very easy way to talk to him, and that's praying. All right. So now we've got a box of either Kit Kats or candy canes. All right. They might be from Christmas, so I'd be careful. Mum's box, not mine. No, you don't want it? All right, it's time for the singers.
Father God, in this quiet moment, we pause and we thank you for the way you've already been speaking to us. And just now, as we delve deeper into your word, I pray a blessing upon your servant as they come and bring your message, the one that you've placed on their heart today. May we drink it in, receive it well, and apply it to our lives this day and in future days, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard. I don't normally get a musical intro, so that was nice. Well, you might not used to be seeing me up here. This is a bit different, isn't it? Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be here. The band probably don't miss me being down there. They probably haven't noticed that I've kind of moved up here. In fact, they probably start to hear my voice and just kind of start to tune out. That's kind of the way it works. They don't always pay attention to me, so I'm kind of used to that. But, you know, over there, we have some good musicians, and they're all looking at me now. They're paying attention. Excellent. We have some good musicians over there, so there are times when we're playing some hymns and marches and that kind of stuff. They probably don't need me that much. They can kind of cope with that kind of stuff themselves. They're good enough to work it out and get the job done. But when the music starts to get a little bit more complicated, perhaps we do need someone to focus on to help to kind of bring it all together, to take it to that next level, to achieve something that perhaps we can't do individually. So yes, I am trying to subtly remind the band to follow me and how important I am. But I think there are some parallels with my analogy in today's theme about being Jesus-centred. So let's move past my subliminal messaging to the band that I am like Jesus. In a life, we think we can do the basic stuff, don't we? On our own, we have the skills and experience to get it done. Maybe we even have a bit of a stubborn streak in us. It's going, you know, I can do this on my own. It's when life gets a little bit harder that we start to think about leaning on Jesus a bit more. Perhaps we don't have it all together, and some help and wisdom may not be such a bad thing. That's right. So having Jesus at the centre of your life when the storms are crashing around you is a good thing. Ensuring Jesus is at the centre during the good times is also the ideal to aim for. When we focus on Jesus, even the good times could be better. We start to notice the little things, see him at work in the detail, and allow Jesus to be an influence to us and to others. If I want to be Jesus-centred in my life, my first question is, why? Why should I think about doing this? Why centre ourselves on Christ? It sounds like a church thing to do, doesn't it? So to answer the why question, I think we need to explore the who. Our scripture reading today gives us the who of Jesus there. So if you've got your Bibles there, you might like to open them up to Colossians chapter 1. Let's just have a look at verse 15 to 18 for a moment. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning of the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. They're big verses, aren't they? These verses tell us how great Christ is, and it's challenges me about how often I stop and acknowledge the glory of God, the supremacy of Jesus. Now, not just pause, but to stop as an act of worship and just focus wholly on Jesus. It's not always that easy to do, is it? It requires some discipline for us to do that. We begin this passage with a really kind of interesting statement. He, in that Jesus, is the image of the invisible God. In a literal sense, the image of something invisible would also be invisible. Yes? If I overthink that statement, it begins to make my brain hurt just a little bit, so I'm not going to do that. What I think this verse is trying to tell me is that the idea of God, who I can't see, is so big and is not easy for my human brain to understand. So therefore, I have Jesus, who is the image of God in human form. He helps me to better understand God because I can relate to Jesus. We have some similar characteristics. This passage comes from the letter written by Paul to the early Colossian church. And he demonstrates how much of a biblical scholar he is in these kind of opening verses here. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth. Does this remind you of another passage? Maybe Genesis 1:1? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. I'm convinced that this isn't a coincidence here, as Paul draws upon that. He's sending us a subliminal message. He's connecting Jesus to the beginning of time. Jesus was always part of the plan, not an afterthought or a plan B. The firstborn over all creation. Now, we all know the firstborn is an important part of the family, yeah? The most important part, yes? Agreed? We have an enormous amount of responsibility. Now, next in line to the throne, which means more if you're Prince William rather than Major David. I guess I say this a little bit tongue-in-cheek, because in modern times, the significance isn't that kind of noticeable, is that most families try and treat their children equally, although the youngest would probably disagree with that. By ancient times were different, and again, Paul is sending us another subliminal message here about Jesus having the place of honour in the family of God, and in fact, all of creation. Christ is mediator of creation, victor over powers, Lord over all God's order. Just pause there for a moment. All things were created by him. He is at one with God. For him, he is the Son of God who inherits all his Father's kingdom. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Now, they are some big statements that remind us of the majesty and glory of God, and he's passed this down to his Son. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. It is through Jesus we gain understanding of God. He bridges that gap for us. That's who Jesus is. Scripture is filled with names we ascribe to Jesus as we attempt to find finite language to understand an infinite idea. Almighty, Alpha and Omega, author and perfecter of faith, bread of life, bridegroom, cornerstone, shepherd, great high priest, Emmanuel, King of kings, Lamb of God, light of the world, Messiah, Redeemer, the way, Prince of peace. We could go on and on. They're just a small few names that we ascribe to Jesus to try and understand who he is and what he does. To understand why we want to be Christ-centered, let's turn our attention to how Jesus has positioned this to happen. We see a shift in focus as we continue through this passage. We come down from the lofty heights of all creation to the depths of human pain and suffering. In verses 19 and 20 we read, "For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." What a contrast this is. We started by declaring the majesty and glory of Jesus. He has all creation at his fingertips, and yet he chooses to make peace through his blood shed on the cross. His blood is shed through an act of violence. His death was not simple, and the pain was drawn out from being flogged to the crown of thorns to the spear in his side and finally the nails. The cross was used as a method of execution for the lowest in society, designed to bring about humiliation and shame. He didn't deserve it, but he still went through with it anyway. Jesus could have stayed above it all, but instead he said, "Bring it on. Give me your worst, I'll take it." This was an act of love, not for all of creation, but for each one of us. God's ultimate purpose is to draw us closer, to reconcile, renew, and bring about peace. The cross and the sacrifice it represents gives us a new relationship with Christ. If believers are to be holy, without blemish, and free from accusation in the future, they must remain steadfast in the faith today. steadfast in the faith today. Verse 21 says, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Jesus did this for us, but it is a two-way contract. For this sacrifice made on our behalf to have its full effect, we need to continue in faith, established and firm, not moved from hope held in the gospel. The best way for us to stay firm is to stay close to Jesus. Not just because his sacrifice, but because life is better all around when we are centered on him. Jesus gives us a hope that is not matched anywhere on earth. Jesus was there at the start of time, and he'll be there at the end. Fads, they come and go, but Jesus is constant. Let's stick with him. This passage is skillfully written to remind us that Jesus spans the creation story of the Old Testament to the cross and redemption message of the New Testament. Jesus was part of the plan. You are part of Jesus' plan. How can we not make Jesus the center when we understand the lengths that he's gone to for us? Surely this is personal. The Messiah, who was there at the creation of the world, made a sacrifice for you. Don't become a Christ-centered person out of guilt or loyalty. Do it because you want to give Jesus sovereignty over your life, because you can't imagine doing life any other way. Becoming centered in Jesus is not a once-in-a-lifetime choice. It requires constant work from us. When we take our eye off the goal, just momentarily, we begin to believe that we can do some of this ourselves. And it doesn't take long before my life is David-centered rather than Christ-centered. No matter how busy we are, we find time in our lives for those things that we find important. Yes? If we maintain the habit of finding time for Christ, then having him at the center becomes far, far easier. The motivation needs to come from within. We each need to recognize the value of doing so. If you're going to make a choice based on my words today, then it's not going to last long. If you're going to make a choice based on what others around you are doing, then it's not going to last long. If you're going to make a choice because you think it's the right thing to do, well, it's still not going to last that long. The drive needs to come from deep within your very being. Last week at Officers Fellowship, we were introduced to a song that wasn't really familiar to a lot of us, but we're going to be using it over the next couple of weeks in different forms, and it really kind of speaks to the theme that we have here today. And the words are relatively simple, but the truths they contain run very deep. Lord, renew in me the fire of your spirit, till I begin to see the power of your love. Make my life to be blazing with your holiness. Father, fan the flame in me. See the words up there. To be holy for your honour, so that Christ be seen in me. This is where it comes to today. So Christ is seen in you. To be holy in your likeness, to be Christ-centred. Father, fan the flame in me. This song speaks of a passion to be holy. When we are Christ-centered, others will see it. We don't need to focus on other people's perception, but it will be a byproduct. When we have Christ in our life, other people will notice. If you want to sit in silence and absorb the words, allow them to wash over you, then do that. We have some people up here who can present the words to us, which is great, because the song might not be well known. But maybe you need to have a conversation with Jesus this morning. If that's the case, then don't wait. Do it. If you'd like to kneel before the Lord at our place of prayer here, then do that. And we can support you and uplift you in prayer as you seek after Jesus' heart. I invite you to have that conversation with Jesus to bring him into the very inner parts of your life and to make sure everything you do is focused on him. Let's sing.
We need the fire of your spirit till I begin to see the power of your love. Make me like to be blazing with your holiness, Father, fan the flame in me.
Accept that gift that's been given to us, Lord, and claim it and celebrate it. Lord, may others around us see that we are centered wholly in you, that we are on fire. As the word suggests, that we are passionate about you and what you bring to us, Lord. Help us to share that with other people. Help us to claim that every single day. Help remind us when we start to stray, when we start to think that we can do things in our own strength. Remind us just to take those steps back to you. Lord, we know that you are there, welcoming us with open arms at every stage. So we want to thank you for that. We thank you for the love you have for each one of us, Lord. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing song today also speaks about Jesus, funnily enough, hey? Lord, the light of your love is shining. In the midst of the darkness shining, Jesus, light of the world. Again, the multiple names of Jesus we have help us to understand what he does for us and to understand the multifaceted nature he has that helps us whenever we need it. We're going to stand, if you're able to, and we're going to sing these three verses. Thank you, band.
Shine on me.
be true for each one of you this week. May Jesus shine upon you and may your hearts be on fire for him. Let me share with you a benediction. As we go into the world, may the living God live within our hearts and be made known in our words and in our works. May each new day bring us nearer to the joys unspeakable. In the precious name of Jesus, amen. Bless you each.